First, about the shirt. You've seen some of us wearing shirts with crosses and asking the question, ask me why I'm wearing this shirt for 30 days in a row. It has been washed numerous times. But the youth of the Diocese of New Jersey have been wearing them since February 4th, inviting people to ask them the question so that they can respond, we're raising consciousness about sex trafficking. And the young people have been asked to record the responses they get, to learn a fact a day so that they can share that. I think it's a great effort in our Canon for Youth and Young Adult Ministries. Debbie Clark, who's here. Debbie, you can raise your hand, came up with that. Thank you, Debbie. I had the honor of first meeting Becca Stevens about 5 years ago when she and some of the intrepid women of Magdalene House came to St. Paul's Episcopal Church in Delray Beach, Florida, where I was serving as rector, to make us all aware of the horrors of sex trafficking and the challenges facing women who are trafficked. She and they also shared with us the phenomenal story of Magdalene House, the program in Nashville, Tennessee, for women who have histories of substance abuse and prostitution, which Becca founded in 1996, as well as the story of Thistle Farms, the business she founded in 2001. And I'm sure you're going to hear the story about both of those entities. I ran into Becca again in the summer of 2014. And by the way, Tracy, too, who's at the table. Hi, Tracy. When Becca was the keynote speaker at the Episcopal Youth Event, EYE, when she wowed about 1,500 young people present. A priest of the Episcopal Church, Becca has been featured in the New York Times on ABC World News, NPR, PBS, and was named a 2016 CNN hero. In 2011, the White House named Becca a champion of change. She was featured in the PBS documentary, A Path Appears, named Humanitarian of the Year by the Small Business Council of America, as well as the T.J. Martel Foundation, and inducted into the Tennessee Women's Hall of Fame. She has been conferred honorary doctorates from the University of the South in Sewanee, Tennessee, and the General Theological Seminary of New York. That's my alma mater. You can give that applause. Thank you. She is the author of several books. Her newest book, Letters from the Farm, A Simple Path for a Deeper Spiritual Life. Becca lives in Nashville with her husband, Grammy-winning songwriter Marcus Humann, and their three sons, and she continues to serve as the Episcopal campus chaplain at Vanderbilt University. It is my great privilege and pleasure to introduce Becca Stevens.
We are thrilled to be in New Jersey, perhaps? Thank you, Bishop. I thought we were in Pennsylvania until about an hour ago. I didn't know. I was like, why is everybody in New Jersey coming to Philadelphia? Because that's where we flew into this morning. And so I didn't realize that when you cross the river, you crossed over. So it is that truth that it's good to learn. I'm sorry? Into the promised land. But it's good to know that you can learn something new every single day. And that's what this conference, I think, has been about. At least the part that I got to listen to is about learning something new. And remembering that on the issues of human trafficking, prostitution, and addiction, that education is not enough. It's not enough to learn something new. We know this as faith leaders in all the communities that we serve, is that it's about brokenness. And that we have to keep coming together, that this work is plenty hard and we need each other. And that in the work of justice, it's a non-competitive field. It's about cooperation, and we all need each other. There's plenty of reasons people fear not getting involved. Was anybody today overwhelmed by the numbers that you heard? Yes. They're mind-numbing numbers. Anybody feel a little bit inadequate to tackle that? Anybody feel like their seminary training wasn't adequate? Anybody feel like the issues are so old and deep, there's no way that we could possibly affect real change? Those are some of the fears, at least, that we come up against in our work over the last 20 years. On average, the women that we serve are first rate between the ages of 7 and 11 and first hit the streets in their early teens. Addiction takes its hold and keeps people within an unjust system for years and years and years. But we're here today to bring you a story of hope, of how people can come together, and how working with small groups of women, you can affect large change. And I have just learned it through work. Just through getting to meet women, just through getting to be with communities that come together and hope and watch it happen. So what we want to do is we want to show you a short video of what this work looks like that is located in Nashville, Tennessee, and then share the story of one survivor, talk for about 20 minutes, and then open it up for some Q&A. Does that sound all right? Yes? All right. Y'all can say amen. Thistle Farms residential program is called Magdalene. They're two-year homes where women can stay for free without any authority living in the house. It's a simple model, but it's critical for survivors of trafficking, addiction, and prostitution to have both space and time to heal. We figured out when the women came that they were doing great work in their recovery and making restitution with the courts and their families. The problem was they were still dirt poor. And that's why we started Thistle Farms, the bath and body care company run by the women. We've also diversified the social enterprise. So we have this cafe, we have the studios, 480 retail outlets, and 18 global partners.
You know, I walked a 10-block radius for well over 20 years, and I could not find a way out. And I was just trapped. I had lost all hope.
I was in a dark place. I came from molestation. I came from running away at the age of 15 and found my way using drugs. And that took me for a whole loop. I became homeless. I've been arrested 87 times. I lost custody of my kids. And I was just lost and bitter, looking for hope.
The women who come into Thistle Farms share a universal story around sexual violence and assault that they've really carried on their individual backs. On average, the women that we serve are first rate between the ages of 7 and 11, and they hit the streets between the ages of 14 and 16 years old.
I used to use for 15 years. I stayed in one facility.
None of the women we serve in the community of Thistle Farms ended up on the streets by themselves. It takes a bunch of broken systems and communities that really roll out a red carpet for the women to find their way into being runaways, to being trafficked, to being addicted, to being jailed, to being prostituted. So it makes sense that it takes communities to welcome the women home and provide the resources and provide a place to restore all of us into a community together.
What's different about Magdalene is you don't have to pay a dollar or anything when you first walk through the door.
They help me with all my needs, like hygiene, dental, food, clothes, a ride. They helped me really get back on track.
It was very difficult to get a job because of my police background, and they hired me. They let me work the register and be accountable for money. They let me go to the bank. But they allowed me the opportunity to develop job skills.
And they did not ask me, what did you do? They asked, what happened to you?
It made me cry. Ah!
The best thing about my life is today is that I lost my kids, and so I have four grandkids, and so the things that I wasn't able to do for my kids, I'm able to do for my grandkids. Like go to the PTA meetings, show up for lunch, drop them off at school just to hear them say, Nanny, can you help me with some homework? Even though I might not know, because I've been out of school for so long. And they love us till we're able to love ourselves.
For 20 years, we've been a witness to the truth that love is the most powerful force for social change in the world. It is that way because people want to hope with us. They want to do this work with us, and we welcome you to the circle. Just talk from there. Oh, you got it. You can just talk from there. Yeah, no, talk with into the mic.
Good afternoon. What I always like to start off with is that it is a blessing to be here. It's a blessing to be here now, and it's a blessing to be here together. I am 47 years old, originally from Indiana. And up until 5 years ago, come May 2nd, I had no clue as to what living a free life was. I come from sexual abuse and mental abuse as a child, all the way up until I was 13 years old, and I ran away from home. That was the only way that I saw anything getting any better. But from that point, it just got worse. At the age of 13, when I ran away from home, I hitchhiked a ride with a truck driver thinking that I was going to come to Nashville, Tennessee to live with my father and live happily ever after. It didn't quite work out that way. That truck driver that I got into the truck with passed me on from truck driver to truck driver through different states until I reached my destination and sold me and made me do things with them in order to pay for my ride. By the time I was 15, I was pregnant, had quit school, working two jobs. 16, I got married, experimented with drugs and alcohol with my husband. By the time I was 18, my husband had traded me to a pimp slash drug dealer, and my life from there was on the streets for the next 25 years. Today, my life is a whole lot different, and I owe that to Thistle Farms and the Magdalene program for saving my life and for showing me a different way to live, and that it was possible in spite of what I had done or what I had been through. That I deserve just as much as the next person, and that I was as lovable as the next person. You know, I had no clue as to what living life was all about. I didn't know how to pay bills. I didn't know how to work. I didn't know how to do any of those things, and I learned all of that through this program. And now I have so many opportunities available to me for education, jobs. I started out at Thistle Farms. I'm still at Thistle Farms, but I've been able to venture out through my process doing other things in the field of recovery and working with other women. And that's where my heart is. That's what I want to do with my life. I think that there's no greater person to be able to help than someone who's actually been there. So that's where I'm trying to go. That's the direction I'm trying to go in. As far as Magdalene, we are. We do have sister communities all over the United States. We help serve about 700 women a year. And the actual house in Nashville holds 30 women. We employ, I think, over 70, 75 women. And it's just an amazing, amazing mission that I encourage everyone to be a part of. I just wanted to share a little bit of myself with you to let you know that it does work. And it's about saving lives. It's about loving unjudgmentally. Love without judgment, freedom, forgiveness, and just have courage enough within yourself. Have the courage to give and to love in ways that you never thought you could. So, buy some products. share the love. Spread the news, and just really pay attention to what's going on in your communities and what's going on in your own backyard. Because a lot of times we think, oh, it's not happening here. You know, our kids are safe in school, college, but it's happening. So just have that awareness and share what you know with other people and be willing to learn what you don't know. Everybody have a blessed day.
So, the way it works for us is we have a very simple mission, and that is we do everything for the next woman who is coming in off the streets. Whether they're coming in from the jail, whether they're being referred by other programs, whether there's a call from another country, state, however women get to us, we are ready for her. So everything we do is preparing for her. Every day we get in a circle and we light a candle. We come out to places and we share the story for that next woman. That's why we are all here. That's how come we go around the world. We have now 20 global partners of groups of folks who are doing this work. And the idea is that the whole thing is set up just to be ready for that next woman. So that next woman could be, where we're headed next, which is Nigeria. One of the girls from Benin, 9 out of 10 girls who are trafficked in Eastern Europe come from Benin, Nigeria, Benin City. And so we're going to help start a program there in 2018. We're going to Greece to work with some women who have survived the war in Syria and have landed and been victims of sexual assault in the camps, and learning what that means to be involved with them. It means the next woman coming off the streets in New Jersey, in Tennessee, and to keep doing that. And it takes all of us working together to do it. One of the things that I have found is that if you do this work, it's not always inspiring. It's a lot of day-to-day drudgery, and that's what love looks like a lot of times. It's, whatever, listening to a story when you're tired, it's taking out the trash when your back aches, it's all of those things. And yet we're called to keep doing that work and doing it and doing it. And what I've learned over the years is that if you keep doing it and doing it and doing it, eventually that work inspires you again and keeps you filled up. And so in this work of justice, which is really healing work, those aren't two separate things, the work of healing and the work of justice. It's the work of healing through this acts of justice and resistance in this world and speaking our truth and doing it profoundly. So, back in November, I was traveling with Sophia, the woman in that picture on the left, and we were in Omaha, Nebraska. And I don't know if you've been to Omaha, Nebraska in late November. But everything is gray. The trees are gray, the sky is gray, the asphalt is gray. It is just gray. And I was really wanting to get home for Thanksgiving and do my life. And they were getting ready to open a sister community there. Like Lori was saying, we have 40 sister communities who have actually opened houses now, and there's another 20 coming on board. We're having a national conference in June, like the one, Lewis, you came to a couple years ago to start this movement for women's freedom. So Sophia was with me. Sophia shares the story like so many of the women. She was in a foster care home. She was abused in that home. She ran away, left school after the sixth grade. And a lot of the women talk about the idea that they're not runaways, they're throwaways, because nobody comes to get them. That they get lost pretty early in the system, and the move from victim to criminal is very fast. She was with me. She was sharing a bit of her story. And I was with her when she was flying for the first time, and she was real excited. And so 4 days later, we've done the fundraisers, we've done the talk, we've done the education. We're on the plane. It's 8 o'clock at night. And she is literally all up in my space on the plane. You know how those seats are. And she's leaning over me, and I'm thinking, just scoot over a little bit, I just need my space. And what I realize is she's looking out the window. It is when we had the supermoon. And it wasn't just a full moon, it was this glowing moon. And it was so beautiful. There was a halo around it, and it lit up all the clouds underneath it, so there were grays and reds filtering through the clouds, and the whole sky was just magical. And she was leaning all over me just to take pictures on her cell phone to share with the folks that are her community now, a wide and large community. And then she looked at me and she said, "I know this is crazy, but I never thought about there being a sky above the clouds." Now, you can imagine how small the world is when you can't imagine it being any bigger than maybe the top of a cell or the underside of a bridge. And that the whole world had just opened up to her. The vast expanse of interstellar space. And the possibilities that means. And what I know what that means is that when we affect one woman, too, that we affect the whole world. That what she does is all about now going and talking to communities about hope. And she preaches the truth that when you rape a young woman, you can kill a village. It is an act of war now, we know that. And when you heal a woman, you heal a village. And it grows exponentially as communities hope together. I really wish it would do it. So one of the very first groups we worked with overseas was a group of women in Rwanda, all survivors of the genocide, all been involved in prostitution since the genocide as they begged on the streets. And they came together to start creating healing geranium, eucalyptus, lemongrass, and patchouli. Did y'all know patchouli's making a big comeback? Yes. And did you know geranium is one of the most effective all-natural bug sprays that you can get your hands on? Yes. All of that is true. And all the women there taught us all of that. And they gave me this hope when we got over there. The first time we went was 2008, and that's when we started integrating some of the essential oils from Rwanda into our products. But what they brought us was this hope that 30 women survivors, you remember the genocide, 1994, 1 million people killed in 100 days, 30 women survivors coming together after that and going back into the fields where they had dug up the bones of their husbands or children, where they had been raped and abused, to plant something healing. And they wanted us to be their partners in the U.S. to try to share that story of healing and distribute so they could make a living and help restore their communities. Now it's 120 women in that community. And what they do is they stamp on their products you know, we are precious pearls. That's what Ikarizi, their group, means. And they ship the oils over here where beautiful women, survivor leaders, blend them into products, and they stamp on them, "Love heals." And then we carry them across the country to say, when we help 5 women, 10 women, 30 women, it grows and it becomes a movement, and it speaks to the larger community about what we're trying to do, which is not just help a subculture of women. It is about changing the culture itself that still buys and sells women as commodities. And we won't get there. We won't get there until everybody joins in together and says, we can do better than this. We can handle this brokenness. We can handle our fears. We can handle the inadequacies. We can handle the really hard days when a woman goes back out, or when we know that the funding is hard. All of that we can do if we come together. I want to say that, it's not just that it's a sweet story about love. You know how church works? Sometimes people think that charity stuff, it's sweet, and we get the leftovers, and it's never enough resources and never enough time. That's not what we're doing here today. We're talking about justice work that is both sustainable and scalable. Isn't that great news for you? It is great news for me. I have been a beggar my whole life. And I don't mind it. It's a noble place within the Christian tradition and with all religious traditions. It's a very noble place to be. But it's more than that. When we were doing this work with women and realizing about how many of the women had never had jobs, don't have anything on their resumes except blank spaces and prison times, you know, it was important for us to be concerned about women's economic justice, well-being, independence. If you want to effect a change for women, and if we want to use the terminology of rescuing, like one of the women said, rescuing them for what? What are we offering? So what we aren't is, we aren't a halfway house. We're not a shelter. We're not a treatment center. All those are beautiful things. That's not what we are about. We are about community. We're about small groups of women coming together free for 2 years to stay in a house. And it's that way because if you're telling a woman who's been on the streets or been trafficked for 8 to 10 years, you have to pay $125 a week to live here, and you have an arrest, 75 arrests, so you're not going to get a job, you're asking them to hustle. That's exactly what we're doing. If you put them in a place with a lot of authority, you're asking them to be triggered for a relapse. Authority is not safe. So we have to come together and serve each other and listen to each other to do this work. So when we started Thistle Farms, we were saying we want women to be able to make a living. And we grew the company, we've grown it all along, and it's proven that we can make margins, we can compete with the big, do you say big dogs up here? With the big dogs. We can. We just did the independent testing on that bug spray that we got from Rwanda. 99.7% effective in the natural bug spray department, independent testing. We beat out Jessica Alba's Target brand. That's what I'm saying. It is good stuff, and it works, and it becomes scalable and sustainable in this world. When we first started, this shows one of the reasons that it's scalable and sustainable is when we come into a community, when a sister community opens up in a place and they start a social enterprise, really you are giving back to the community. Because we don't take any federal or state money, we can show that just by being in Nashville, Tennessee, we help give back to the city more than $1 million a year. That we have something to say. We can speak about legislation. We can speak about justice. We can be a player on that, and we can do better together because we have a lot of different bottom lines. We have a powerful mission. We can show love is good business. We can show that healing women makes the women safer, makes the community safer, and it helps our children and all of that. So when we started and we were starting to think about this scalable and sustainable model, one of the women that came in off the streets early on was a woman named Katrina. Katrina's mom was preparing for her funeral. Katrina is the woman sitting down, and that's her daughter, Ebony. And Ebony was a little girl. Katrina came in, and we did what we always do, which is pass out a card when women first get in there, and you can write notes or you can draw a picture, and to say, what is your hope? What is your dream? And the reason we do that is because the truth is you can prostitute women, you can addict them, you can traffic them, you can jail them, you can do all of those things, you can rape them, all of it. But you cannot kill hope in women. You cannot do it. Never has anyone not written or drawn anything or set a goal in their lives. We all have them. So Katrina came in, beaten down, sick as a dog, and her daughter was with her. And when they passed out the card, you could hear Ebony say to her mama, draw a house, mama. Draw a house. She just wanted some place to live and be safe and heal. So then Thistle Farms is starting to get up and go. We have about 10, 15 stores. And we say, Katrina, do you want to be our national sales director? And she said, and I'm not cussing, I'm just quoting a cusser. Oh, hell no. And I said, okay, I hear that as yes. And so Katrina reluctantly became the first national sales director, and she is still the sales director, and she developed a team of survivor leaders. She worked with people. We grew and we grew, and she built a house for she and Ebony. She ended up getting married again. They adopted a child. Ebony goes off to college. And then Katrina says, look, it's too much for this sales team. We need somebody specifically that has some expertise and that can work with just the Whole Foods accounts. We have now 110 Whole Foods. At that point, we had 110 Whole Foods accounts. So she goes out, she does a national search for a director of sales for the Whole Foods account, and she comes back and she said, I've hired Ebony. I was like, that's awesome, because Ebony knows exactly as much as we do. We're all on the same page. And Ebony comes back, and in March of this year, we get a call from Whole Foods, and they say, look, you guys are doing great. We love your new sales rep. All we need to do now is pitch it to the entire Whole Foods and see if for 2016 holiday season, we can get you a global buy-in, meaning 430 stores. So, Ebony's been on the job for like a month and a half, and we go, guess what, Ebony? You're going to Anaheim, and you're going to speak to the entire Whole Foods. And Ebony said, oh, hell no. And Katrina said, I hear that as a yes. And Ebony flies out, and as she's leaving, she said, what will I say? What am I going to say to all these people? And Katrina and I were just like, all you got to do is stand up there and say you were a little girl brave enough to dream of a house. And when you were able to speak it in a safe place, a whole community could come around you to help make that dream come true. And through hard work, through days that are very gray, through beautiful people who hope, it all happened. And we can do this social enterprise, and we can do this justice work, and we can keep doing it so the next woman has a job. Ebony, you're doing this for the next woman and that next child saying, I just want a house. She goes out there and she does it. Whole Foods loves her. So we went from 120 stores to 430 stores. We have doubled our manufacturing space. We bought brand new equipment. We made something like 50,000 candles this past year. We have hired maybe 6 or 7 new women just from that one speech she gave. It's a beautiful thing to hope together. It is good and right to fear and be overwhelmed by this sometimes, but it's not the end of the story. The end of the story we don't know until we all come together and pull together with our resources, our time, our talent, and treasure to find out what's next? How powerful is this healing among us? What can we do if we do all come together? We don't worry about various not-for-profits stepping on each other's toes. We don't worry about denominational differences. I don't even know what they are anymore. I can't even remember. Isn't that awesome? It just all fades away in the presence of love. And that's what this work offers us, is to be in the presence of hope and love, to overcome all that and come together and light up this country with candles. Thank y'all very much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Oh, thank you in the back. Who I'm with is, I am with Kim, who is one of the great candle makers that I was talking about. She is an expert candle maker, and she has taught many of us how to stay away from the equipment, which when we want to help. And Lori, who does a lot of the inventory work, and she is getting her counseling, peer counselor degree right now as she does that. And Tracy, who you saw in the video, who has 14 years with Thistle Farm. I always say that. 12. I know. I always say that. I did that not too long ago. 12 years with Thistle Farms. She is one of the manufacturing directors and trains the young women that come through. But I think we have time for a few questions, which is what we wanted to leave time for before we ended. And it can be comments and it can be questions. But really, if you want in-depth information and knowledge, if a small group comes to the national conference, you'll be with advocates and survivors for 2 whole days to get all the information you want. But if in a few minutes you want some more information, besides all the different products you can buy, and we can give you more information out there as you are purchasing your graduation presents, Mother's Day presents, all of those things, you'll be done if you get it all today. You'll be done. You're welcome. So, what do y'all got on your minds? Hearts? It can be for any of us, too, if you have questions. Go ahead.
Do you use Planned Parenthood?
Do I use Planned Parenthood? The partnership we have is with the Rape and Sexual Abuse Center. So every woman that comes in, the reason that we do small communities for women, so each house has 5 to 8 women in it is what we recommend. And there is no authority that stays in the house, but everybody develops the goals I was talking about. And one of the main things is to do trauma therapy. So when women come in and they're going through 90 days usually of outpatient treatment and they go to the sexual assault center, that's where most of the trauma therapy happens for us. People have individual therapists, but not. This is the first year we've, not, that's not true. This is the second year we've had all the employees of Thistle Farms have health insurance. That's huge. So we don't do doctor visits with women, but we do use the Rape and Sexual Assault Center as one of our best partners. What else have you got on your hearts? Yes. What does a partnership look like? So it's called an affiliated network. And the idea is that all of us are independent 501c3s. So we're all 501c3s. Some are faith-based, some are not faith-based. But there's core values. There's 4 core values, which I just talked about, which is long-term free housing for women survivors. And that we are working towards economic independence for women. The way it looks, it'd be best if you went on the website to look at all the details of it. But really, the main part of it is that we all come together, we do conference calls together, and it could be about a legislative piece they've passed in New York, and all of us want to learn about that piece so we can adapt it to our own state legislatures, whether it's about expunging records or restitution for trafficking survivors, all of those issues. It could be about women and babies. What happens when a woman is pregnant with a baby and she's coming in? How can we have safe houses? There's three houses that have that in Northwest Arkansas. And so there's referral processes where a woman can have her baby and be in housing with her in that. That's not true for every program. But that we can all come together and say, we need help. We had a woman who had been a huge part of our community that relapsed, and Nashville was no longer a safe place for her. And we were able to refer her to one of our sister programs in St. Louis, Magdalene House, St. Louis. And I just talked to her yesterday, 4 months later, and she's in that community. So that it's a lot of referrals, a lot of best practices, and continually trying to come together. Do y'all have anything you want to say? I'm just.
Yes. We are in
We
are in desperate need of teacups. We are remodeling our cafe. And so that's a way that y'all can help us out, please.
We're making chandeliers.
Out of the teacups.
So one of the social enterprises is a cafe, and it's the story in every cup. And y'all know that the industry of tea and trafficking are closely tied together, from the opiate trade back in China, and it continued, and the abuse and the human trafficking associated with the tea industry. So we've kind of claimed some of that back. And so we're making this beautiful, like, long chandelier, and we're trying to collect 1,500 teacups with stories. So we would love your teacups. That's thank you for saying that, Tracy. Yes, and you heard me talk about Katrina. Her email is katrina@thistlefarms.org. We love retail folks. That's awesome. And there's ways that she does it for the wholesale bulk selling, but I don't know all the details on that. Yes?
I hear you have a lot of wraparound services for the women that come in.
Yes.
From that, your entrepreneurial endeavors there, is it based on training or is it based on the gifts and talents that the women show?
Is our social enterprise based on your talents or is it based on the training you get when you're at Thistle Farms? Hold the mic.
Well, I think it's both. For me, it's like I used for 15 years. I did not know that there was a way out until I got to Magdalene. I didn't believe in the God until I got here. But now I am a quality control manager. And so now I'm going to school to get my GED. So it's like they help us with all our needs. Whatever that woman need is, they provide that need for us.
What did y'all want to say?
I would say both as well. I think that we all kind of get ideas of what we would like to do once we get there. And we get the opportunity to watch the other women work, and we say, oh, I think I want to do that, or, you know, and then we do it and we find out that we're good at it. And so the additional training that we receive is a plus and allows us to learn to do it even better. And so I think it works both ways.
I also think it works both ways. A lot of us come in and we don't know that we can do anything. But once we get to Thistle Farms, you know, we're so broken and our self-esteem is so low. When you get in a community of love and healing, all that starts to come back because they love us until we can love ourselves. When we're afraid, when we go on the job site and we don't think that we can do it, they insure us and they walk with us and they show us and encourage us that you can do this. And before you know it, you know, you're a quality control specialist. You know, I am a manufacturing manager now.
Becca. I'm sorry.
Becca. And you know, in as far as like a lot of us are foreign to computers, but they throw us in there and it's like, no, you can do it. So it's both. You know, I wouldn't trade this upon for anything in the world. You get such a healing there. Like, these are my sisters. These are going to be my sisters for the rest of my life till I die. You know, we fight, we argue like sisters. One day we might be mad and we'll speak to one another. But let something be wrong with one of my sisters, we rally together and we love on that sister, or if they're in need of anything, you know, we're there. I just wouldn't trade for anything in the world.
I think one of the most important things that I heard one of the women say is that the biggest lie she was told, and this is a woman whose mom sold her to a drug dealer when she was 12, the biggest lie she was ever told was that she was stupid. And when you get told that for a long time at that age, I think that you start to believe it.
Yes, you call that reality.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That was the funny thing in the video when Tracy said, "You made me cry." I was like, "You cry every time."
That's because I've been numb for so long. People don't understand why I cry. It's a blessing.
Yeah.
It's a blessing. I mean, they can say, "Tracy, how you doing?" They go, "Tear." It's like, I can feel that. Concerned about my well-being. It has been so long since I was in love. It has been so long. So thank you. Thank you.
What were you going to say?
I heard two things that seem like they're the bedrock of your organization. One is that we're built aimed at the next woman to walk through the door.
Yes.
It's all about that next person.
Yes. That's right.
Yes. Then use the mic.
Well, for me, it took me 3 months just to say my name when I got into the program with the rest of, with 20 other women. I did not know who I was. I felt scared. I felt lost. But then now I can see when the other woman come in, how she so afraid, she don't believe in herself, and then when she start to bloom, that is the blessing. Can't nobody tell our story but us. We the only one walk through it, and Becca always tells me that. So that's why I cry. Because at first I tell myself, you ain't got nothing to give. Don't nobody want to hear what you gotta say. I got a lot to say. So that's mine.
For me, when I first walked in the door, I was not a very trusting person. I didn't believe that anybody could give me anything without expecting something in return. Okay, that was my mindset. And when I walked in and I received such love and lavishing gifts, I couldn't believe that it was all being given to me out of love and free. And so I learned through being there that there is such thing as a gift, and there is true love in this world. You know, I thought for sure, two years, free rent, clothes, bed, food, job, education, freedom. There had to have been a catch. There was a catch in there somewhere, and I'm just waiting for it to come. But it never came. But what came was self-forgiveness, self-love, self-respect, all of those things that I never had, that I never experienced in my whole life. And when another woman comes in and I see the look on her face, the actions of her body, and I know exactly what she's going through and how she feels because I was once that woman, it's easy for me to embrace her and to tell her that it's going to be all right, but do it also accordingly and not so pushy, because I was scared to like let somebody hug me at first or do anything physical, you know, because I was afraid of all those things, because that's what made me think, okay, here it comes, you know, they're going to want to have sex with me next, because that's all I ever knew. Like I thought that that's what life was about, was having sex to get everything, all my needs met. It was about having sex. I'd never been anywhere or slept anywhere where I thought I didn't have to have sex to be there. You know, on one of my first trips with Becca, it was such a weird feeling to be at a hotel and to sleep in a hotel room and not have to have sex in it to be there. And I know that that sounds so common for me to share, but it's the truth. Like, I'd never experienced those types of things in my life to be able to enjoy where I was, to see the beauty. This hotel is beautiful, but I'd never had the opportunity to look around and see how beautiful hotels could be or how good the food was. You know, none of that. I went on one trip. I didn't even know the ocean from a lake.
That's true.
I was standing in the middle of it with my bare feet, and I said, oh, my God, I'd never seen the ocean before. And Becca was like, well, I'm sorry to break it to you, but you still haven't seen the ocean. You know, so, okay, so, you know, it's just experiencing it's experiencing life for the first time. You know, and that's what we want other women to experience. And, you know, show them, you know, life can be great.
The question was, how do you feel about the next woman coming in or something like that?
For me, when I came in, I was also afraid. I didn't trust people at all. I was so used to living in the streets that I had this just natural wall built around me. I didn't like women at all. I mean, and to have to live, be in a community with 30 other women, you know, it was just like, ooh, I'm not like them, but I am them, you know, but as you stay around in the program, things change without your permission. You know, God is working, and you don't even know it, you know. And light bulbs start to go off, and you start to feel, like you say, your tears start to come back, and you start to, you know, if your sister hurts, you hurt. And I start to get all these feelings that I didn't have before. And then to see another woman come in, and she still has that hard shell, like Becca said, like a thistle. You know how a thistle is prickly on the outside, on the inside it's fuzzy and soft. You know, you see that thistle come in, and it's beautiful, but it's still prickly. And to watch like the layers fall off, and to develop compassion and empathy, you know, for the woman that comes in, it's a beautiful thing to watch a new sister come in and blossom, you know. It's a beautiful thing.
So we want y'all to have time to shop. So what I was going to say as we close is that you are exactly right on the things you picked up about what our themes are. And the last one I want to leave you with is you can be lavish and economical. I think a lot of times we think in the work of the church that we have to do it on a shoestring, and we don't. We can create a community and a shelter like a cathedral, and we can still do it way cheaper than it costs to send someone to prison. And to do it that way is the way to go. So dream big, stay together, and let us know how we can help. Thank you.
Thank you.